Okay, so we will again look at sorting. Many of these algorithms, merge sort, okay, quick sort, and some of these other sorting algorithms that we've studied, all of them seem to take n log n time, right? Yeah, I think it's a good question to ask if we can do faster. Can we beat this n log n, which most of these sorting algorithms seem to take? And this is the question we would like to address in this part of the course. Okay. In fact, we'll show that for a large family of sorting algorithms, you know, n log n is the best that they can do. Okay. If we sort of restrict the kinds of things that algorithms can do on inputs, then n log n is the best that we can do. Now, if you look at merge sort, okay, let's take merge sort, but whatever I say is actually true even for, let's say, quick sort. Now, for merge sort, what really happens? You split the array into two parts, okay, and then recursively sort these things, and then you merge these two sorted arrays. Okay, that's the crucial step. Okay. What happens when you merge two sorted subarrays, or when you merge two sorted lists? Well, you compare two elements and then move them around. Okay, compare the first element in the list, that's the smallest, and you put it as the first element, then move your pointers and so on and so forth. So the most important step there is comparing two elements and then some reordering. Okay, so the only operation that you actually do on these elements in the array is comparing two elements and moving them around. Okay, so this property actually holds even for quick sort. So how does quick sort run? You pick a pivot, you know, by your favorite procedure, and now you compare every element with the pivot. Okay. Once you compare every element with the pivot, and then you move these elements around. So the basic operation on two elements of the array is compare these two, figure out which one is larger, which one is smaller. So again, the crucial sort of operation is looking at two elements in the array, comparing them, and then based on the result, I mean, if one is smaller than the other, or the first one is bigger than the other, then you sort of either switch them around or change the order. Okay, so this is the crucial operation that you do on the array elements. You don't add them, subtract them, divide them, you know. And so the operations that one will use, we use in at least these popular sorting algorithms, is compare two elements, maybe swap them, or, you know, move them around. If these are the only things that you can do with array elements, then you need n log n comparisons to sort an array. Okay, so this is our goal. So that's what we are going to show. Well, how do we go about doing this? Well, even if you recall, you know, we showed that find the minimum, you needed n minus 1 comparisons, right? And even there, it was not an obvious sort of, the solution was not absolutely obvious. You had to do a little bit of work. And for this, actually, we need to do a little bit more work, but it's not difficult, okay? So the first thing is to notice that these algorithms can be written as flowcharts, okay, or comparison trees. What's a comparison tree? Well, the basic block is a comparison between two elements. Okay. So I compare two elements ai and aj of an array. Well, I branch this way if ai less than aj. I branch this way if aj is greater than ai. We'll assume that array elements are distinct, okay, which means I'll never have two of them equal. Okay. So compare two elements, branch this way if ai is less than aj. Branch the other way if AI is greater than AJ. Now, using these as building blocks, I can build a large flow chart. Okay, so somewhere here, maybe I can compare two elements, two other elements, AK and AL, okay, and then again branch, and so on. And at the end, I'll have these leaves where I will output. So the output for us is a sort is the order, is a sorted order. Okay. So we will look at flow charts which look like this. Okay. The input to a flow chart is just an array A. Okay. The input is an array A. And you go through these flow charts, and at these leaves will output the sorted order. This is the model that we are looking at. Let's do a small example. Okay. So for instance, if I have two elements, then okay, let's say A1 and A2, I compare A1 and A2. Okay. If it's less, then the order I output is A1, A2. Okay, this is in sorted order. If A1 is larger, the order I output is A2, A1. So here is a small flow chart that sorts two numbers. Okay. So it sorts two elements. Basically works on arrays of size 2 and sorts these arrays. Okay, so let's say 3. Okay, what if the array size is 3? So let's see what to do. So you compare, let's say A1 and A2. Okay. Now if A1 is less, let's say I compare A1 with A3. Let's say A1 is less. Okay. Now I know at this point that A1 is the smallest, so I would like to compare A2 and A3. So here A2 is greater than A3, here A2 is less than A3. The sorted order here is A1, A2, A3. Here it's A1, A3, A2, and so on. So you can sort of fill this up. So you can write down a flow chart like this. These are the leaves where you get the answer, which is the array in sorted order. Okay. Now merge sort can also be depicted like this. So let's see why that is true. Okay. So let's look at merge sort for when it's four elements. So I have four elements A1, A2, A3, A4. Okay. And I want to sort of run merge sort on this. Well, we divide this into two. Okay. Recurs on this part, then recurs on this part, and then there is a merge. Okay. When we recurs on this part, okay, the first comparison we do is between A1 and A2. So this is the first comparison we do, and this could be A1 is less than A2. This is A1 could be greater than A2. We don't know what this is. Okay. Here the sorted order which is returned here is A1 A2. On this side it's A2 A1. Okay. Whichever branch we choose, now we have to recurse on the right hand side. So this is the next comparison we do, A3 and A4. And well, these give again two sort of outputs. And now at this step we are up to the merge. Okay, the lower things return these two sorted orders, and now we are down to the merge in the top level of recursion. So let's take this portion. Okay. What are the two elements that are compared? Okay, here I know that A1 is greater than A2, so the first one returns, this side returns A2, A1, right? And here I know A3 is less than A4, so the second list return is A3, A4. These are the two lists. So the two elements compared here are A2 and A3, right? The smallest elements from the two lists are compared now, right? So this is what is compared here. So let's go down one more step and see how this looks like. So here A2 is less or A3 is less. So supposing we followed this branch, what is the next two which are compared by merge sort? Well, A3 is less than A2, right? So A3 is moved to the new list, right? And our pointers are at A2 and A4. So the next two things which are compared are A2 and A4. Okay, and so on. I can draw this tree out, and at the leaves of this tree, okay, are the solutions. I mean, at each leaf, I'll tell you what is the output, what is the sorted order, which is output, right? In fact, if you look at this tree, this tree is a binary tree, right? At each internal node, we have a comparison. So you compare two elements, and you branch out into two. Right, and for each branch again there'll be an internal node, you compare two elements, branch into two, etc. So if I just look at it as, if I forget that there are these comparisons, etc., etc., the whole structure looks like a tree, in fact a binary tree, and there are leaves, and at these leaves we have the output, right? Output meaning the sorted order, right? So when I sort of follow this tree down to a leaf, I get the answer, and at this leaf, whatever is the answer is output. The one thing to notice is that this tree is different for different sizes of the input. Okay, for four elements, I can tell you what the merge sort tree looks like. Okay, the comparison tree for merge sort, it has some structure, and in fact, just the way I have written part of the tree here. You can actually write down the entire tree. Okay, it will take some time and space, but if you have the patience, you could try this out. Okay. For five elements, again, there is a tree. For six elements, there is a different tree, and so on. So for if I fix the number of elements to n, then for merge sort, I can write down a comparison tree which does the comparisons in the same order as merge sort. Okay. So if I follow the tree down for a particular input, the comparisons made will be the same, the order of comparisons will be the same as that made in merge sort, and the answer will be as given by merge sort. Okay. So how much time, what is the notion of time here on this tree? Well, the time taken for, let's say, given an input, the time taken is just the number of comparisons you make till you hit a leaf in this tree, right? So given an input, you make comparisons, then you branch either on the left or right, then you make some other comparisons, branch, etc., etc., and finally you hit a leaf. Okay, the number of comparisons is just a path, you know, in this tree from the root to a leaf. Okay, so the time taken is the number of comparisons, which is the length of the path followed from the root to a leaf. Okay, so then the worst case time, okay, what is the worst case time by merge sort would be just the height of this tree, right? The worst case time for merge sort will just be the height of this tree, which is the longest root leaf path in this tree. Okay, if I can show that this is long enough, okay, then the time taken for merge sort will also be that much. Okay, and that's the goal. And we have most of the ingredients in place. We just have to make certain observations. Okay. Okay, here are two critical observations. So we have an algorithm as a flowchart. Okay, we have an algorithm which sorts n numbers. Okay, and it's depicted as a flowchart where, or a comparison tree where at each node you compare two elements and you branch depending on which one is greater. Okay, at leaves we output sorted orders. This is the deal. The question we ask is how. What's the height of such a tree? Okay, how tall is such a tree? Okay, here are two sort of crucial observations. If this flowchart does sort, then every input order must leads to a leaf. Okay, different input orders lead to different leaves. Okay, so why is this true? Well, firstly, we'll assume that inputs in our input, every element is distinct. So we do not have two copies of the same element. Okay, there are n factorial orders that are possible as input, and for each order, you make certain comparisons and you trace a path to a leaf. Okay, and at the leaf, you have to give the right order, which is a permutation of the input, right? For every input order, you must end up with a different leaf because the permutations are different. Okay, so for instance, if I look at 1, 2, 3, this is already sorted. If I look at 1, 3, 2, okay, the sorted order is 1, 2, 3. So I have to interchange the last two elements. This order must appear at a different leaf, right? Which means all of these n factorial permutations must appear in one of these leaves, okay, and different permutations must appear at different leaves, right? So, because the order of the input is different, I must land up in different leaves. If I land up in the same leaf, I'll give the same answer for both orders, which is incorrect, right? So, this means there must be n factorial leaves in this binary tree, okay. Each of these different orders must land up in a leaf, and different orders must land up in different leaves, which means there must be n factorial leaves in this binary tree. Okay. So intuitively, you can see why the height must be large. Okay. So if I have a binary tree with a large number of leaves, the height better be large. Okay. So we'll just invoke theorem which you must have seen in discrete structures, and we'll finish the proof. Okay, so if I look at this flowchart or this decision tree, then I have a binary tree. Okay, and I know that number of leaves is at least n factorial. Okay. Using these, I want to conclude that the height is at least something. Okay, so if I can put something here, if the height is at most at least something, then I know that the time taken by the algorithm must also be at least this much. So what can I? Why is this? Why can I say that the height is at most something? Well, supposing I have a binary tree of height h, what's the maximum number of leaves that this can have? Okay, this is something which you have done in discrete structures. So let's state this. So binary tree of height h has at most, well, 2 to the h leaves. Okay, the number of leaves can be at most 2 to the h. Well, let's I hope you can sort of prove this, but let's give a proof anyway. Okay, so proof is by induction on H. So the base case, I'll let you do this. Okay, H equals 1. I'll let you do this. Okay, so the inductive step. Okay, so how do we do this inductive step? Well, let's look at a tree that T be a binary tree of height, let's say k plus 1. So we'll assume that the statement is true for all binary trees of height k or smaller, okay? And we would like to prove the statement for height k plus 1. Okay, so the inductive hypothesis is that for every tree of height k or smaller, the statement holds, and we would like to prove this for a tree of height k plus 1. Okay, so if I look at T, T has a root, and then there are two subtrees. Okay, this is what it looks like, T1 and T2. Okay, now well, I remove the root, so remove the root, and now I'm going to apply induction to T1 and T2, and apply the inductive hypothesis to T1 and T2. Okay, well, this had height k plus 1, okay, which means both T1 and T2 have height k or less. Okay, one of them has height k, the other could be k or it could be less. Okay, so the height of T1, is less than equal to k. Similarly, height of T2 is less than equal to k. Okay, that's the reason we can apply the inductive hypothesis. Both of them have height less. Now we can apply the inductive hypothesis. So the number of leaves in T1, is less than equal to 2 to the k. Similarly, number of leaves in T2 is less than equal to 2 to the k, right? Okay, and now you can see basically the number of leaves in T is number of leaves in T1 plus the number of leaves in T2, which is this plus this, which is at most 2 to the k plus 1, and that's the end of the proof. Okay, so let's just write this. So number of leaves in T equals number of leaves in T1 plus number of leaves in T2. That's less than 2 to the k plus 2 to the k, 2 to the k plus 1. And that finishes the inductive proof that on a tree of height h, binary, when I have a binary tree of height h, the number of leaves is at most 2 to the h. Number of leaves is less than equal to 2 to the h. Okay. Well, taking logs, I get log of the number of leaves is a lower bound on the height. Okay. Well, we know, remember that in our binary tree, the number of leaves was n factorial. So the height, okay, this means the height is at least log base 2 of n factorial. Well, this is the height of the of any of this tree which is related to any of these flow charts with sort, flow charts or for sorting, we looked at these flow charts. Okay, so we said that number of leaves is n factorial, and we've just seen that the height must be at least the log of n factorial. Okay, so what is this? We are very close. Okay, log of n factorial is at least, okay, log base 2 of n by 2 to the n by 2. Why is this true? Well, this is true because n factorial is n into n minus 1, blah blah blah, somewhere n by 2, okay, and then all the way up to 1. Now, if you look at the top n by 2 terms, all of them are greater than n by 2. right? There are n by 2 terms, right? There are n by 2 terms, and all of them are at least n by 2, all of which, all of whom are greater than or equal to n by 2. So n factorial is at least n by 2 to the n by 2. Well, that's why this is true, and this is nothing but n by 2 log log n by 2. Okay, this is omega n log n. Okay, so the time taken is at least n log n, which is what we proved, some constant times n log n. So this shows that merge sort, for instance, we know it takes maximum time n log n, but there are inputs on which it takes time n log n. It must take. Okay, so similarly, quick sort. And any other algorithm in this model, which is, if the only thing which you which the algorithm can do is look at two elements, compare them, and perhaps move them around, sort swap them, for instance, or move them around. If this is the only thing that's possible, then the time taken by any such algorithm for sorting must be n log. There are sorting algorithms which do not fit into this model. We will not cover those. Hopefully, you have covered some of them in your data structures course. These are bucket sort, radix sort. Okay. Well, these algorithms differ in that you can look at the least significant digit. Okay. You can divide. You can take floors of these numbers. Okay, they are integers. You can take floors and do funny things with them. Okay. The difference between these algorithms and, let's say, something like merge sort is, merge sort, when you look at two numbers, the only operation that you can do is comparison. Okay, on any element, if I take an element of the array, the only thing I am allowed to do on this element is compare this element with some other element in the array. Okay, I cannot sort of divide it by, you know, 10 20 100, whatever. I can't look at its least significant bit, etcetera. Okay. Yeah, so that's as far as sorting is concerned. We'll continue with our discussion of algorithm design techniques by looking at some other problems which are fairly interesting, and where this divide and conquer paradigm sort of works and gives you better results. Okay, in some cases, perhaps the algorithm that we desire. Okay. The first one is this. Okay, so you're given, okay, a 2k, so this is the input, by 2k square. Okay, and what you want as output is a tiling with, I'll tell you what all this means. Okay, with this. Okay, what do I mean by a tiling? A tiling essentially means I must fill up all these squares. I must try and fill up as many squares as possible with pieces which look like this. So each piece is, let's say, a kind of a domino which sort of looks is of this shape, and I want to try and fill up as many squares as possible in this. Okay, so, well, you can see immediately that I may not be able to fill up all squares, right? Even for k equals 1, if I have a 2 by 2 square, okay, I have a 2 by 2 square, well, I can put one of them, right? So I can put something which fills up these 3 squares, and this will be an empty square. Okay. So here is a tiling of a 2 by 2 square with a domino of this form, which does everything except one square. Okay, so what about 2 to the k cross 2 to the k? Well, the number of squares, if you look at the number of squares, is 2 to the 2k, right? These are number of squares. So number of squares, and this, okay, is 1 mod 3. I'll let you figure this one out. Okay, The number of squares is always 1 mod 3. Well, it's 2 here, okay, and you can see that it's always 2. If you want, you can prove it by induction on k, but even otherwise you can sort of check that the number of squares will be always 1 mod 3. Maybe we'll just look at k equals 2, okay. So then it's a 4 by 4. Okay, how does this look like? Well, yeah, so this is a 4 by 4 thing, and you have, well, 16 squares, and that's 1 mod 3, right? When I divide this by 3, I get 1. So 3 times 5 is 15 and 1, okay, 1 gets left out. So that's true whatever k I choose, right? It's always 3 times something plus 1. Yeah, so that's what I mean by 1 modulo 3. When I divide by 3, I get 1, the remainder is 1, okay. So can I sort of now put these dominoes, okay, so that all except 1 square is covered. So I have this 2 to the k by 2 to the k square. Okay, so I have a square with side length to the k. I have these dominoes, which each of them has 3 squares, you know, put together. Can I now put these, can I arrange these on these squares so that all except 1 square is covered? Okay, this is the question. The answer is yes, and we would like an algorithm to do this, right? And well, we would like to do it using divide and conquer. Okay, that's the goal. Okay, so let's do this 4 by 4, and then we'll see what's the scene. Right? Can I do a 4 by 4 with so here is a 4 by 4 square. Can I do this? Well, since I'm going to do something like divide and conquer, okay, I would like to divide this into 2 parts or more, in this case 4 parts, tie each of them and put them together. Well, let's take a bigger one and see how this is done. Okay, so okay, I know how to tile this so that 1 is left. I know how to tile this so that 1 is left, and so on. Now, how do I tile the whole thing so that 1 is left? Well, supposing the 1 left here is this, okay, 1 left here is this, and 1 left here is this. Now I am able to tile all 4 of them, okay. So I tile this so that this is my first domino, okay. I use my first domino there, I put it around like this. This is my second domino, I put it around like this. Here is 3, okay. It does not matter how I put my fourth as of now, okay. We'll change this later. Supposing the fourth is like this. Well, now I can put the fifth domino here, 5, 5, 5, okay. So I managed to sort of tile at least 4 by 4 using 5 dominoes. I have just 1 left, which is what I want. We would like to repeat this for 2k by 2k, okay. So how does that look? So here we again would like to do a divide and conquer, okay. We would like to divide this. I would like to first tile these 4 and then put them together. Well, by looking at this example, I can do it if provided the square left off here is this, the square left off in this is this, the square left off here is this. Here I really don't care, right? If I can tile the entire region here except this corner and so on for these 3, then I am able to tile the entire region on top, okay, leaving 1 square. That square left will be in this big sort of region, okay. This is 2 to the k minus 1, 2 to the k minus 1, 2 to the k minus 1, and so on. So this whole thing is 2 to the k. Okay, so if I can do this, then I can fit in this extra sort of domino here, and there'll be one square left over in this region. Good. So again, notice a crucial thing: to be able to carry this inductive process, okay, to completion, I should be able to have the extra square, I mean the square left over, as a corner square. Right? When I tile a region which is like this, the leftover square must be a corner square. So this is a square left over or left untiled. I've tiled the entire region except this small square. If I can do this, then clearly I can do the big thing. Okay, so I started out, my initial objective was to tile 2 to the k by 2 to the k, right? That's what I started out with. I want to apply this divide and conquer kind of thing. Well, actually the process is really induction always. Okay, if I can do it for a small square, can I push it up to a bigger square? That's the goal. Well, we want to do divide and conquer, so we saw that we break it up into these 4 smaller squares. Okay, now I want to tile these smaller squares and then put them up to a tiling for the bigger square. Well, each of these smaller squares, there is one, you know, one square, one small square which is not tiled, one piece which is not tiled. Now if this happens to be the corner, okay, then I can push the induction upwards. Okay, but for the induction to work, even the final, okay, so let's look at this again. For the induction to work in this big square, I want the one square which is not tiled to be a corner. Well, it can't be a corner here because everything else is tiled. This cannot be a corner, it cannot be a corner. Well, can it be this corner? The answer is yes. So I can leave this square untiled. So leave this. Now when I look at these 4 small problems, they all look absolutely alike. I want to tile everything except a small square in the corner. I want to tile all of it except this square in the corner, except this in the corner, and except this in the corner. And I put them together like this. This tiles the entire big square except for this one thing in the corner. And well, this is the algorithm. Okay, break it up into 2, tile these 4 recursively and put them together like this, and in the middle I just put one domino. Okay, one domino fills up these 3 squares. So I have tiled everything except this. So this is a, well, divide and conquer sort of strategy to tile squares. So this problem looks a bit different from the other problems, and that's why I picked this, because the strategy can be used not just for computer algorithms, for puzzles, for whatever you have. Okay. And the other sort of lesson that we learn through this example is that you start with some problem you want to solve. We've seen this before. Okay, along the way you would like to apply, you know, you find solutions to smaller sub problems. You want to put these together to get a solution to a larger problem. And while doing this, okay, you may want to solve something slightly more general. Okay, and then you see if this general problem can be solved. Okay, so you try and solve the general problem now again using the same technique. The smaller sub problems, you solve the general problem, and now see if you can put them together to get a solution to the general problem for, you know, for the big input. And often this sort of gives you the solution that you want. Okay, we saw this in 2 occasions. One was the tiling problem, the other was I hope you can remember, it was when we looked at this median, right? We wanted to find a median, but we ended up looking at the problem of finding an element of given an array and a positive integer r. Okay, so we found an element of rank r. Okay, that's what we did. Okay, so let's look at one more problem, yet another problem rather, which uses divide and conquer. Okay, so this is a familiar problem of multiplying two integers. Okay, so let's look at this. So I have two n bit integers x and y. Okay, this is x, this is y, these are n bits. Okay, each is n bit long, and I want to find the product of x and y. Okay, the normal way is, well, you form the product of each of these bits with the LSB and then with the next one and so on, so on, so on and so forth. So there are n squared multiplications. Well, in this case actually it's not just, you can just do OR and since they are bits, but you can think of these as, instead of bits, you can think of them as digits. It really doesn't matter. Okay. So each of them could be n digits long, and you multiply these digits. So there are n squared multiplication. This is the high school multiplication algorithm that we know. Okay, can we do faster? Okay, that's the question. So let's try applying divide and conquer. Okay, so I divide this into two parts. This is x left, x right. Okay, y left, y right. Okay, and now I want to compute the product of these two. Well, what is the product? First of all, x is nothing but 2 to the n by 2 times xl plus xr, y is 2 to the n by 2 yl plus yr, right. So this means xy is 2 to the n xl yl plus 2 to the n by 2 xl yr, right, xl yr plus yl xr, yl xr plus xr times yr. This is the product, okay, of x and y. So we could recursively sort of find these products, these four products. Okay, and then compute this. This is just shifting by n bits. This is shifting by n by 2 bits. So that is an order n operation. So if tn is the time taken, okay, this what's the recurrence? There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 problems. Okay, so 4 times tn by 2, right, plus order n. This is some constant times n, which is for shifting and adding to n bit numbers. It takes order n time. Okay. Okay. So what's the solution to this recurrence? Okay. What's the solution to this recurrence? Well, I'll let you do this, and the solution to this recurrence. Okay. If you do a solution to this recurrence, it's order n squared. So we are back to where we started. Okay, so if you compare these two, well, we have done divide and conquer, but we don't seem to have conquered anything. Okay, we are back to spending order n squared time, even with this divide and conquer approach. But well, all is not lost. Okay, so I'll first indicate this algorithm, and then we'll analyze and see how we can decrease the number of multiplications. Okay. Yeah. So, well, the trick is this. Let's see. So the terms that we want to compute are xl yl. Okay, and then xl yr plus yl xr and xr yr. These are the three terms that we would like to compute. Okay. The way we did it was each of them separately, that gave four problems of size n by 2, correct? Okay. So here is a smart way of doing this. Well, these two I compute as they are. Okay. The third thing I compute is not quite these two, it is the following. I compute xl plus xr times yl plus yr, okay, I add XL and XR, I add YL and YR, and I then multiply them together. What is this? This is XL YL plus XL YR plus XR YL plus XR YR. Okay, that's what this is. So I do three multiplications and not four. This is the first multiplication, XL YL. XR YR is my second multiplication, and this is the third. Okay, this I don't do as of now. I have not touched this. This is the third multiplication I do. Well, if you look at this, XL YL is present, XR YR is present. Okay, and if I remove these two, what is left is this, right? XL YR plus XR YL is exactly this. Right. Well, I have just written XR YL, but the same as YL XR. Good. So, how do I compute this? Well, from this product, I just subtract these two to get this. So, call this Z. Okay. Now, I just do Z minus XL YL minus XR YR. I get this. Good. What have I done? Well, I have a few more additions. I have 1, 2, 3, 4 more additions, but the number of multiplications has gone down by 1. Okay, multiplying 2 n by 2 bit numbers, I do 1, 2, and 3. So there are now only 3 multiplications that I do. So what's the recurrence now? Well, Tn is 3 Tn by 2 plus order n. Earlier, remember, it was 4 t n by 2 plus order n. Now it's 3 t n by 2 plus order n, and it's not surprising that the solution to this recurrence is smaller. Okay, in fact, we'll show that the solution to this recurrence is order n to the log 3 base 2. Okay, roughly, it grows as n to the 1.59. which is certainly less than n squared, which is what we started out with. Okay, so this, the number of multiplications one makes, is significantly smaller. Is 3 t n by 2 plus some. Let's just take n; doesn't matter. Okay, so t n is this. Okay, we'll do the usual thing, which is 3. Okay, so 3 t n by 2 squared, right, plus n by 2 plus n. Okay, this is 3 squared t n by 2 squared, okay, plus 3 times n by 2 plus n. Let's do it once more to see what happens. Okay, so this is 3 squared t, well, n by 2 cubed. Okay, sorry, this I am expanding this out, so there should be a 3 here, 3 times, okay, plus n by 2 squared plus 3 times n by 2 plus n. Okay, so this is now 3 cubed t n by 2 cubed, okay, plus, well, 3 by 2 whole squared times n plus 3 by 2 n plus n. And now I guess one can guess the general term in this. When I go down I steps, okay, so t n will be 3 to the I, okay, t of n by 2 to the I, right, plus 3 by 2 to the I minus 1 n plus 3 by 2 I minus 2 n, so on to n. Okay, good. So now we would like n by 2 to the I should be 2, okay, or say 1 for ease of computation. If this is 1, if I have, you know, 1 bit, then the time is 1. So the time is just, this becomes t of 1 is 1, okay. So if this is true, right, then t of n is 3 to the I plus, well, n times 1 plus 3 half and so on up to 3 half to the I minus 1, okay. Well, okay, let's do this. So this is 3 to the I plus n times, well, what is this? This is just a geometric series, okay. So it's roughly some constant times 3 half to the I, okay. You can do it more a bit better by doing the writing the exact formula, okay, which is 3 half to the I minus 1 by 3 half minus 1, okay, right. So it's at most, well, let me put it at most. So this is perhaps 3 half minus 1, which is half. So C could be 2, okay. C is most probably 2. In any case, this is bounded by something like this, okay, 3 to the I plus. So what is I? Well, 2 to the I is n. So I is nothing but log base 2 of n. Good. So this is 3 to the log base 2 of n plus n times some constant times, well, 3 half to the I, which is 3 halves to the, well, log base 2. Now, 2 to the log base 2 of n is nothing but n. These two things cancel. So I have 3 to the log base 2 of n times constant and 3 to the log base 2 of n here. So this is nothing but some c prime times 3 to the log base 2 of n. Okay, this is the time taken. So what is this? Well, so the total number of multiplications is 3 to the log base 2 of n, which is 3 to the log base 3 of n divided by log base 3 of 2, okay. Okay, I could take this up, so this is nothing but 3 to the log is 2 of 3 times, these are just some general manipulations, right. So that is 3 to the log base 3 of n, I take this inside, okay, n to the log base 2 of 3. Okay, this is nothing but n to the log base 2 of 3 as promised. So this is roughly n to the 1.59. Okay, so the time number of multiplications, we got it down from n squared, which was the initial thing, to roughly n to the 1.59. Of course, we increase the number of additions, but if multiplications are more expensive than additions, then we have saved on time. Okay. This trick of using 3 multiplications instead of 2 is actually a trick. It's something you have to really need to come up with somehow. Okay. There is no real sort of way in which you can do it. There is no method, and that's the beauty of algorithm design. That somehow, you know, not every problem can be sort of tackled using everything that you know. You could come up, often you come up with, all the time you come up with problems which require you to design new methods, derive new methods, find new methods, rack your brains and sort of come up with, you know, good algorithms. And when you do come up with these new algorithms, you feel, I guess, the kick that you derive or the pleasure that you derive is something else. This trick, by the way, for this multiplication is due to Euler. and he used this for multiplying complex numbers. Okay, we've just used this trick, was then used by other people who saw that it can be applicable in multiplying to n bit numbers. Okay.